4.4 per thousand, 5.37 per thousand. Obviously, it looks like town A has a much larger food deficit. And if we scan down the age-specific death rates, you can see that identical. This is where our difference occurs, in the older age category. In the older age category, Sunny is actually slightly less. But we also have a preponderance of older people. The population structure for the Sunny place and for the rainy place, for B, it's inverted. This has a preponderance of young people, this has a preponderance of old people. That's where we're getting this difference in current death rates. Okay, young versus old. Okay. Think Florida versus Bangor or something like that. I don't know. We're talking about the East Coast. However, when we go through the standardization and adjust for age, we find out that it's actually slightly higher in town B, although pretty much comparable. You really can't test for statistical significance. But I'd say 6.98 is pretty close to 7, and 7.33 is not very much higher. So, age adjusted, the death rates aren't that much different. What we're seeing is the different population structure, preponderance of young, preponderance of old. And that's what's driving up prudent death rates. This is exactly the phenomenon that I was talking about in class when I presented this material last week, right? So that's the kind of discussion I would ask you to do on the exam. Compare the crude death rates. If they are substantially different, and like I said, there's no statistical test, but usually I will give it to you so that it's not something that you have to split hairs. That's obvious, I think. 5.37 versus 9.4. That's obvious. And that's the type that I would give you. Okay. Look at the population structure or something else about the two populations that might explain that. Look at the age-specific rates. See if there's any variability there. Then look at the age-adjusted rate, and if it becomes similar, you know that they have fairly equal health statuses, but it's due to something else. In this case, it happens to be the structure of the population. Questions thus far? Did you guys... I know I outlined this pretty closely, but did you come up with similar comments? Okay. Any other questions or comments on this problem?
So crude is effect. So your crude rate is that basically a raw rate then?
Crude is raw. Yeah, you could think of it that way. Crude is simply the looking at the aggregate death rates, where age adjusted takes into account population structure as compared to a standard population. Because that's another thing that you would look at is compared to the comparison to the standard. Standard population doesn't have quite the preponderance in the older category, but it also doesn't have, so if you look at the older versus the younger, standard population is younger, so this town B is more aligned with the population structure of your standard population that you're using to compare it to. Okay?
So, Dr. Max, take for example, we have the age-adjusted population of town A to be 2.98. and compare with town B, 7.33, right? How do we explain the differences in words without looking at the table?
Okay, if it were 2.98, without looking at the table, you really can't.
Oh, okay.
You need all of this information over here in order to interpret that. All you can say is that when you adjust for age, it's a much healthier population, but you can't say why. But if you have this table, then you can take a stab at the reason.
Okay. But looking at a population structure, I can say that I don't even need to calculate those to know what's going on there.
Probably not. I made it obvious.
Yeah.
I mean, I made this up so it would be obvious. It might not always be. It might.
Okay.
Some, it's usually probably going to be a little more subtle than that.
Okay.
Other comments, questions? Okay, let's take a look at problem two. And here we have a group of chemical workers, number of deaths recorded, observed, in other words. And we have, remember with SMRs, we have our comparison is a death rate in the standard population rather than the number of people per category in the standard population. So here we're dealing with the death rate. In this case, it happens to be per 100,000 people. And then we have the male chemical worker population. Okay. So in this case, we have to go in the opposite direction. We have a standard US male death rate. So what we have to do is come up with an expected death rate based on the standard for our worker population. Okay. So this involves the SMR, standardized mortality ratio, confidence interval chi-statistic, and then the interpretation. So with SMRs, we can actually find whether it is statistically significant and conduct a confidence and construct a confidence interval on it. Okay? So here's our SMR. Okay, so we have four age categories, we have worker population, and a standard death rate. Oh yeah, and then we have the same type of problems here for a semiconductor company. And I wanted you to do SMRs on both of them. So this is the chemical company here, this is the semiconductor company here, obviously. In each case, we have observed deaths. The expected deaths, remember, is you have to expect it based on the worker population. If this is the standard death rate per 100,000, so that you have to take the worker population divided by the standard death rate, or multiplied by the standard death rate, and then divide out your standardization number, 100,000 in this case. So that means we have 0.39 deaths. And we go through the same process, and we get the number of expected deaths if they were behaving like the standard U.S. population. As you can see, we would expect a lot more. This is a healthier population, just looking at that. And then the SMR is observed divided by expected, 0.51. Is that significant? Construct our confidence interval. And you guys remember the SMR confidence interval calculation. Now, we'll remind you, it's those. That's why I give you equation sheets. It'd be idiotic to memorize that. But that's why you should also print out your equation sheets when you do the homework. Because if you can do the homework with just the equation sheet and the tables in front of you, then you can do the exam. That's my intent. So anyway, this is confidence intervals formulas that we're using, and 95% and for 95%, 1.96 is the z-score that we use. So I look at those confidence interval and what do I think about that immediately? Lower limit of 0.14 and upper limit of 1.3.
Captures one.
It includes one. Therefore, it implies non-significance. Because it includes one. Because remember, one is a deflection point. It's less than one. population is healthier than the study population is healthier than the standard population. It's greater than one, the study population is less healthy than the standard population. If it's equal to one or not statistically different from one, which that implies, then there is no statistically significant difference. So we go down here, we calculate our chi-squared. Chi-squared is always observed minus expected square root over expected, right? This is a universal chi-squared formula. Okay? Observed minus expected square root over expected. It's always some permutation of that. Yes?
Just say it three times fast.
That's as fast as I say it. So this is observed, 4 minus expected, quantity squared over 4. We got 1.91. What do we compare it to? 3.841. 3.841. 3.41 is nice, but 0.84 is fine. So, because that's chi squared. Can I borrow your
tables again?
I have a call IT. For some reason, PDF files won't open on this, nor GIF files, nor JPEGs, or anything that's useful.
3.84, he's showing me how to get it. Just the 0.95 on the degree.
I really did this guy first.
I remember it. 1.6, 1.605.
And then I had to remember the statistics. They'll come back. Just listen.
We'll just say numbers and have a point.
Okay. 1 degree of freedom, unless otherwise indicated. I'm only interested in the upper bound of the confidence interval. I don't care about the lower bound. So therefore, I use chi-squared of 0.95, 1 degree of freedom. 3.841 is my critical value.
Can you post this on Canvas, correct?
I did. Okay. Yeah, and it's under, you know where it is now. And it's all under the topic too. Anybody has trouble finding this stuff, just let me know and I'll show you where it is. Okay, so that's where the 3.84 comes from. Therefore, this is not statistically significant because it's not greater than 3.84. And the way that you would write this, if you were trying to write it for my consumption for some odd reason, you would write this that chi-squared 0.95 with 1 degree of freedom equals 3.841, and that is greater. It doesn't matter which way you do it. The chi-squared statistic equals 1.91. Therefore, it is not statistically significant. So this is not statistically significantly more healthier population, even though it looks like it. Their expected deaths are twice what they actually observed, but it's not significant. So despite appearances, it's still, they're no better, no worse than the standard population. Same thing is true here. We have our standard death rate, worker population, calculate our expected deaths, and our observed deaths are actually greater here. Here it looks like we might have a less healthy study population. But again, we do our confidence interval, it includes one, it's pretty broad, but it includes one, so that implies that it's not statistically significant. And our chi-squared here is even smaller, 0.6. So it's the same thing here, except take 1.91 away, and you write 0.6. And the conclusion is the same.
So I think I'm going to ask a stupid question here. So you're looking at the lower limit and the upper limit, and you keep using the term it includes one.
Mm-hmm.
So that statement is throwing me off.
Okay. Think of a time line or a number line. Remember way back in the ninth grade when you did number lines?
Yes.
Okay, we have 0, 1, 2, 3, et cetera. Okay, let's put dots there. And this is my number line.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's take a look at this copy. So 0.14, that's down here.
Yes.
And 1.3, let's say that's about there. If I draw that limit, it includes 1.
Okay.
That's the sense that I'm using it.
Okay.
Does that help? Let me finish Prince's question on it too.
It does help in terms of, you know, explanation, but why do we have to reference that to the lower level and the upper level? Why do we have to reference that?
Because one is, if the SMR is one or not statistically different than one,
yeah,
it's no effect. That's why one's important.
Oh, okay.
Okay. There are instances where it should be other than one, but we'll talk about those when we get to them. Here, for now, it's one.
Okay.
Okay? Okay, Savannah?
So, trying to get this right. For the lower limit, upper limit, that's in regards to the SMR then? Or is that in regards to your 1.96?
SMR.
Okay.
This is a 95% confidence interval on the SMR.
Okay. And the SMR is just the mean, basically, the mean. I
would say. SMR is the statistic for this sample. Okay. And this is the 95% confidence interval on what it would look like in the population as a whole.
So can you have a SMR that is significant but your chi-square shows non-significance?
No.
Okay.
Well, it is extremely rare. Occasionally, if it's borderline, you'll get something that you... It's right, what either the upper or lower limit is one, and this, I actually made up one inadvertently for one of the classes where the lower limit was one and this was 3.84. So, I don't know how I did that.
That's
just
lucky,
I guess. What's that?
Did you save it?
I did, it's around somewhere. That's a good one. But you never will encounter that. If these don't agree with each other, you probably should check your arithmetic.
So, SMR greater than 1, starting population at greater risk than reference population, and everything below that, what are you comparing, which number out there are you comparing to that?
What is your standard death rate?
This is the SMR that we calculate from, so we compare this.
Yeah.
But we also compare these because this is the 95% lower limit and 95% upper limit of the SMR.
Okay.
So we're interested in all three of these compared to that, you know, less than 1, 1, greater than 1.
Okay.
Does that help?
Yeah. So, but for the second one, then, is kind of where I'm confused because the SMR is greater than 1 in that case, but then between the lower limit and the upper limit, we're looking at 1.
We still have 1 in there. So. Despite and I did this on purpose. This looks like it's like they're more healthy, but it's not statistically significant. This looks like they're less healthy.
Less healthy, but it's still not. Okay,
still
so
not
you still have to double check that raw SMR
That's
with
right.
the lower level. Okay.
That's right. Yep. Because this doesn't tell you anything that you can draw a conclusion from. These two
mm-hmm.
do.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So the chi-square is more of a redundant.
No, it's chi-squared is an actual test of statistical significance. The confidence interval is only an implied test of statistical significance.
So, to get a significant SMR, both our lower limit and upper limit have to be above 1?
Or less than 1.
Or less than 1, okay.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to have the extreme, so to speak, of both under or both above.
That's right.
Okay. And then we only compare chi-squares to 1.96 for the same deviation, correct?
To 3.84.
Or 3.84, SMR is 1.96.
Yeah. The SMR, we use the z-score of 1.96.
So with the SMR of 1.25, you see they are more healthier. It's a more healthier population?
They appear to be. However, when we test it, they're not.
Okay, I see.
And like I said, I did that so that we would get SMRs that would lead us to one conclusion, but then our statistical test negates that conclusion that we're led towards in both of these cases.
I'm just looking at the SMR interpretation you have down here. You see if it's greater than one, study population is at greater risk than the reference population.
If it's statistically significantly greater than one. That's really what, I didn't write it in that way, but that's really what it means. It has to be significantly greater than one, or significantly less than one. Otherwise, in both of these cases, these are found to be not statistically significantly different than one, which means that there's no effect. So it's the same as what I have there, equal to one.
Okay.
Because remember, what we're testing here, you remember the null and alternative hypothesis statements? Did you guys do these?
Yes.
Null and alternative hypothesis statements.
Yep.
In this case, the alternative hypothesis, and I'll write this very crudely, is that the SMR is not equal to one. The null hypothesis is that the SMR is equal to one. This is no effect. Okay, and in this case, we can't reject the null hypothesis. So we assume no effect, but the SMR is equal to one. If we could reject the null hypothesis in either one of these cases, then we would know that it's not equal to one. And if you want to be picky about it, and maybe I'll regret saying this, but I'll say it anyway. What's this alternative hypothesis imply?
That they're different.
That they're different, yes. But this implies a two-sided test, right?
Two-tailed.
Or two-tailed. Yeah, sometimes called two-tailed or
greater than or less than.
Two-sided, which means that, strictly speaking, what could you use as your critical value if you're doing a two-sided test? Because that means
0.975? No, the 0.9, right?
Well, it depends on what your
0.05 is always 0.05.
Yeah.
Okay. Alpha is always 0.05.
Yeah, so you're dividing your alpha.
Divide by 2,
then you would actually use that.
By 0.024, strictly speaking. But I just
that's farther down the line.
I'm sorry?
That's farther down the line.
Yeah, kind of. But what I was assuming with 3.841 was that we're really only conducting a one-sided test because we're only interested in one direction in each case. Okay, so one-sided where you've used 3.84 would be either SMR is greater than one or SMR is less than one. So what I'm assuming is that here, I'm only testing to see whether it's less than one, because I want to see because that SMR looks like it's less than one, so I'm doing a one-sided lower tail. Here it looks like it's greater than one, so I'm doing a one-sided upper tail. So that's why I use 3.84. Okay. If I wanted to be really compulsive about this, I could say I'm always doing a two-sided test and use 5.041, but I didn't do it that way. Now, if it was between 3 and 5, then I might get a little bit concerned about it. If these chi-squared values were between 3 and 5, then I might think about it a little bit more. But usually, it's an extreme. It's obvious. It doesn't matter which one you use. Okay? See where I'm going with this? Okay. I'm going to take that for a yes. Okay.
We'll see, Ken.
Sorry?
Okay.
For now, I'll take it for you. Yes. Okay. Next one. Again, we have two study cohorts. Less than 40, greater than 40, very simple, and a reference population that we use for both study cohorts. I made them really simple. The numbers don't matter. What's important is the interpretation of it. Okay. Again, SMRs, chi-square statistics, compare and contrast the two cohorts. There we go. Okay. All right. So for cohort A, I put in just to remind you how to calculate it. Since this is rate per thousand, and what's different here is we're using person years, doesn't matter, but this is per 1,000 person years. So these are our rates. These are our strato-specific rates, SMR, as observed over expected. In other words, this over this. And summary SMR then is 2.42. Looks like our study cohort is less healthy than the standard comparison population, from which we got a reference population, from which we got those two. Well, in this case, I got 2.1. That's a very tight confidence interval. That's pretty good. 2.19 to 2.67. That does not include one. Right now, I have an effect. It looks like I'm going to get an effect because it looks like our study population has an increased death rate for whatever reason. I do my chi-squared calculation. See, this is why I don't quibble too much about whether it's 3.84 or 5.04. Right? That doesn't matter. It's significant no matter how you look at it. So that's significantly elevated death rate in this study cohort. Right? And the same thing is true down here. A significantly elevated death rate in the study cohort. Now let's say that I used a more stringent alpha, okay, which looking at these chi-squared, I can certainly do. And these chi-squareds are gigantic. So I can use a more stringent alpha. So let's just say I decide to use an alpha that's 0.01. Okay, now remember this, the top one, this goes from, it's basically 2.2 to 2.7. Right? So remember that, 2.2 to 2.7. I tighten my alpha to 0.01, and it's a little bit wider. Okay, 2.12 now to over 2.75. See, as you decrease the alpha, you get you broaden the confidence interval. But these data are so good that it doesn't broaden it very much. Okay? We still get a pretty tight confidence interval and a pretty convincing one that there's that there is an effect here, that the SMR for our study population is significantly elevated, 2.5 times, as a matter of fact, what the reference population's death rate is. Okay. And here, we can do the same thing. I'll just for the hell of it, I'll increase this to a very small alpha. And again, it's grins and giggles, I don't know, whatever you do things for fun. So in here, you get a 1.74 to 2.52. And it's a pretty tight confidence interval. Questions about that? Again, what we're testing is whether or not this is significantly different from our, you know, SMR less than one, SMR equal to one, and SMR greater than one. I read my own handwriting. That's what we're testing for, to see where it falls in there for a statistically significant test. Our test of statistical significance, sorry.
So was this a two-tailed test, and then did you pull the 2.58 from the normal table?
Yes. Good question. 0.01, that means that our, if alpha equals 0.01, then alpha 2 equals, 0.01, and alpha over 2 is 0.005, right? And that means that 1 minus alpha over 2 equals 0.995, right? So, how did we get that 2.58? I have it programmed in here because Excel does strange and wonderful things with the normal distribution, but you won't have Excel. So let's take a look at what you will have, which is these tables. And let's look at the standard normal table. Since I know it's going to come from that side. Everybody see those numbers?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. 0.995. Where is 0.995? It is about pretty in there somewhere.
Yeah, it's right there.
Yeah, it's about halfway in between there. So you can go either direction, or you can try to interpolate. Don't interpolate. It's not worth it. And to get the z-score of 2.58, I mean, let's look at the 0.9951. It's 2.58, or 2.57, or you can do 2.575 if you really want to do that. I don't care. That's right, Al.
Which is it?
What's that?
Said, which is it? Interpolate, don't interpolate.
Don't interpolate. Don't waste time trying to interpolate these, okay? I just have to use them a lot so I remember. Don't do that. Okay. Well, use them a lot and remember, that'd be great, but since you're using people, just go to either 2.57, 2.58, I don't care. Because in the long run, it's not going to have much of an effect on the result. It's only at the hundredths value that you're going to see a difference. Okay? Does this make sense to everybody?
So we don't need to do the equation of, I think it's alpha minus, or it's 1 minus alpha over 2.
Well, you do in order to figure out this 0.995. You do. Because, see, I said alpha is 0.01, alpha over 2 is 0.005, 1 minus alpha over 2 is 0.995. That's how I figured out where to go on the table.
Okay.
You get the 0.995.
Yeah. And are there any factors that show that this equation, or this test was a two-tailed test for us, or? Did you just decide to modify
confidence
it?
Intervals, and unless you take system safety, you can believe this. Confidence intervals are always two-sided. For those of you that are interested in system safety next semester, we'll find some that aren't. That's just for next semester. They're always two-sided, so you always do 1 minus alpha over 2. Okay? All right, so let's take a look at, any more questions about this problem?
In terms of resuscitation, we are not using the chi-statistics, right?
No,
the chi-squared.
No, I think
we're using chi-squared because chi-squared is what tells us whether or not this is statistically significant. All of this that I went through was just to do the confidence interval.
Oh, okay, and so we're sure that from our equations, we can tell that our study population is significant.
That's right, because wherever you go on chi-squared table, one side, let's just say one-sided, on the chi-squared table, our critical value is 2.841.
Yeah.
These are much greater than that, so these are statistically significant in both cases.
Okay. Do we need to know the reason why and be able to write that out in the answers for the exam, per se?
That would be a lot easier than trying to explain it. You can either write this or write a paragraph. I'd rather read this. To be honest with you,
don't worry.
Yeah. So I suggest writing it like this.
So to be able to find the confidence interval, would you give us the alpha?
I would get at least give you the alpha, if not the z score. Right? There are some cases where I can't give you the z score because it's part of the problem. But this is, it's really not part of the problem here, so I'd probably give you the z score. Or use 1.96. If I say alpha is 0.05, you immediately know the z-score is 1.96. Because it's the one that's most commonly used, 1.96. Okay. All right. Now, this is a power and this is a powered question. We want to detect a relative risk of 1.6. The proportion of exposure among the control group, I give it to you, is 0.3. I can give you the 2x2 table and have you calculate that, but that's, again, that's a little bit more roundabout than I care to be. Alpha is 0.05, just by default, we always take alpha 0.05. And the number of cases and controls is 100 each. Therefore, the total number of people in the sample is 200. Okay, 100 cases, 100 controls.
Yes. I have a question about that.
Okay.
So what's our n?
N is 100.
That threw me off.
It's very, very confusing. Yeah. N is 100. It's the number of cases and the number of controls. But the number of cases and controls is 200.
Correct.
Yeah, it's 200. Yes. I know. I know. I didn't write the damn question. I don't know.
I did this one twice.
Yeah. We got extra practice on this.
I did.
Yeah, the n is 100 in this case because it's the number of cases or it's the number of controls. The total number of people in the sample is 2n or 200. Just
so
the way the equation is.
So should we look at it more as an or then? That, since you just said that?
Yeah, that's probably a safer way to look at it, yes. And we're assuming that they're equal. That's not always the case. But so that means that if n is equal to 100, we should have at least 200 people. How they're distributed between cases and controls, we're usually stuck with that.
Gotcha.
Okay, so power, what does it mean? And tell me how you would increase it. Okay. So remember, we're going to erase all this. Okay, so we want to detect relative risk of 1.6, did I say yes? 1.6. And we know that P proportion among controls, of exposure among controls is 0.3. Alpha equals 0.05, blah, blah, blah. And we have big N equal to 100. That's another thing I don't like. It's big N. That's supposed to be sample. That's supposed to be population.
Mm-hmm.
It's the way the equation is written. Okay. So, let's take a look at it. And so this is the form of the equation, because I asked you to give me the power. You have n, give me the power. So that means that you have to solve for n, and I think I have a typo there. It should be a big
N. Well, I was just looking at your equations, though, because it's the measures of agreement that has the big N.
Oh, it is the measure of agreement.
For your,
maybe I'm remembering it wrong.
Gamma statistic?
Okay. I was complaining for nothing, because I like to do it so much.
You can complain about that later.
Yeah, I'll complain about that later. Oh, that's getting started complaining. Okay, so here's our givens. Alpha equals 0.05, so therefore, we can find Z01 minus alpha over 2, which is 1.96. Just, we know that. And again, let me illustrate it, just because I want to I want to make sure that you guys understand it. I don't mean to belabor the point. I don't mean to belabor the point, but I'm doing it for a purpose. Okay. 0.975. It just happens to be on the table. 0.975. 1.96. That's our z-score. So that's how we get the Z01, 0.96, Z01 minus alpha 2. We have P sub 0, P sub 0 here, is 0.3, Q sub 0 is 0.7. Relative risk, what we want to detect is 1.6. P sub 1 is P sub 0 times the relative risk, and Q sub 1 is just 1 minus P sub 1. So here we got calculate the P sub 1, calculate the Q sub 1, and I just do some intermediate values because they're in the equation there. It's easier. P sub 1 minus P sub 0 quantity squared. P0 Q0 plus P1 Q1 is 0.46. And therefore, then I just take that n of 100. Put n of 100 in here, this value there, take the square root, subtract 1.96, and I get z of 1 minus beta is 0.7. That's not the answer. That's just the z-score of the answer. Right? Well, the 0.7 is because this, the output of this equation is the z-score, not the power. It's only the z-score. So we take that z-score of 0.7. Remember, we're talking z's now. That z-score of 0.7. Now we're talking z-score, so 0.70. And that's my power, 0.758. Okay. You have to go from z to probability and from probability to z, back in both ways. We were talking about alpha, then we had probability and we had to get the z-score out of it. Now we're talking about the z-score of the power, and we have to infer the power is 0.758, so about 76% power.
When you're looking at these, do you care, like, if I got 0.6951? When
that's
I did the
pretty 2.6? Far off. Where did you get the 0.69?
Oh, I'm sorry. That was wrong. My bad. No, I got 0.7549. 0.6951 was the z score that I read.
Oh, okay.
So I got 7549.
Okay. And 0.7549.
That was the last one.
Oh, that one there. Why did you read it 0.69 instead of 0.7? Was it because of the results of the calculation?
Because of the results
of
what
okay.
I got. Is
yeah,
that okay?
Yeah. Actually, that's
you see
what
okay.
I'm because,
okay.
Because if you get a z score, as long as your power corresponds to the z score that you get, as long as you show your work, then I know what you did.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. So that's okay, yes. Okay? So, I said, so what can we do to get a better power? Although that's pretty good. If I really had a power of 0.76, I'd be happy. But to improve, what are some things you'd do?
Increase the sample size?
Increase the sample size is what? Okay, so let's increase it from 200, which is 100 cases, 100 controls on the average, to 150 cases or controls. Okay, wait a minute. No, I don't have my cap locks. There, 90% power now, just by increasing that. Okay, but that's a big increase. Okay, that's from 200. That's a 50% increase in the sample size, which could be substantial. Where's my cat? Where's my control Z? Here we go. What's another thing we could do is expect poorer resolution. In other words, instead of detecting a resolution of 1.6, I increase that to, let's say 1.8, see what that does. Again, just a slight increase in the resolution that we're, or decrease in the resolution that we're willing to accept increases the power. Let's say 1.7. It's still pretty good. Now we got a 0.87. So this is something that doesn't cost us anything, but it reduces the resolution. Because instead of detecting 1.6, now we can only detect 1.7. Now let's decrease that from 1.6. Let's say 1.4. See what happens. Now we've dropped it all the way down to 43% power, which isn't great. But this gives me a pedagogical opportunity, put it this way. What do you do with a negative z-score? Because that's right. And why is it negative? And what? How does that translate? Negative z-score, negative 0.18. Let's take a look here. Okay, because the z's here are positive. Now we go over to this side of the table, to the negative z's. Point negative 0.18. Because, what did I say about the standard normal distribution? We assume that the mean is zero and standard deviation equals one. So that means that the z-scores from here, here, z is positive from the mean to positive infinity. The negative infinity, the z-scores are negative. So since this is a negative 0.18, that means it puts it in not very far. It's only a tenth of a, about 2/10 of a standard deviation, but in here somewhere. Okay, so this, that z is negative 0.18. And that means that the probability is 0.4286. Okay? Is that making sense?
Would you like us to draw that, or?
Not necessarily, unless it helps you to remember it.
Okay.
I'm just only, I'm drawing it to help you understand why it is the way it is. Is this making sense to everybody? Is this bringing back memories of signal detection theory?
Mm-hmm.
No, signal detection what? No, Savannah.
Well, probably just reinterpret the significance or not significance the same way. It's just saying that it's most likely, I guess. Is that it?
Significance, non-significance is a binary state. It either is or it isn't. I guess I'm not understanding your question.
The negative doesn't really represent anything.
It doesn't represent significance or non-significance.
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
This only has to do with the location in the standard normal distribution. That's all it has to do.
Okay.
Because z is dispersion in the negative and the positive directions. Okay. So the answer to the second, to the third question then, is we can decrease the resolution by increasing the relative risk, or we can increase the number in our sample.
And for the second question, what does a figure mean? What would you say for that?
Oh, the 43%, that means that 43% of detecting an effect when an effect actually exists. This is what I'm looking for. Power is this. In other words, correctly coming to the conclusion of the alternative hypothesis when in reality the alternative hypothesis is true.
Okay.
And that's what power tells us. As opposed to statistical significance, that tells us that we have a very low likelihood of what, no greater than 1 in 20 of a type 1 error. And that's what statistical significance tells us. Power tells us something different, which is the likelihood that we're going to, the power to detect a correct alternative hypothesis. Does that help?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody understand the distinction between type 1 error and power? Because for whatever reason, we are obsessed with this side right here. We want to know that if we get alternative, what does that tell us about it? It tells us, alpha tells us the probability that it's wrong, and 1 minus beta to the power tells us the probability that it's right, essentially. But those aren't complementary.
just like signal detection. They're not complementary, they're two overlapping standard normal distributions.
So decreasing the resolution helps to, it affects the power.
That's right, it improves your power because you're not trying to detect something, you're not trying to detect something that's a small effect. You're all trying to only detect a grosser effect.
Okay, and you're looking at effect size here.
Yes, effect size, exactly. Other questions about this problem? Okay. All right. 5 and 6 are both measures of agreement. So in this one, I wanted you to try out kappa and Krippendorf. And in this one, I want you to just do kappa and think about Krippendorf, because Krippendorf, it gets too complicated to do it by hand. It's easier to do it kappa, to be honest with you. So anyway, first one is physicians, and they have patients that present with CTS. How much agreement do they show in their diagnoses? Okay, for kappa, all we need is the agreement table. And so we've got row and column totals, or P's and Q's, and we end up with a kappa of 0.32. That's pretty bad. Yeah. Kappa of 0.32, if you go up here, you can see that they, out of 15 patients, they disagreed on 5 of them. That's a fairly high number. I mean, 0.32 shows an agreement that is not very good. Now, with Krippendorf, you have to then transpose the table and do what he calls a data matrix. So here there are four cases of agreement on no carpal tunnel syndrome, there were 12 assessments. On agreement of carpal tunnel syndrome, there were 4 patients, 8 assessments. So remember, the data matrix, the number is number of assessments, not the number of patients. And then of the remaining ones, you divide them half and half between disagreement. And the reason is because of the way disagreement is handled in the equation. It doesn't matter what type of disagreement, only the disagreement existed. And the coincidence matrix then is agreement that is present. There were 4. There were 2 where A agreed to said it was present and B said it was not. 3 more where A said it was not present, B said it was. And then 6 where they both agreed that there was no disease present. You don't really need the coincidence matrix with these simple ones, because all you really need is the number of I should have taken this out. That's right. I know it's not right, as a matter of fact. This is only here for the equation, so ignore it past this point. You just notice that. Because the D sub 0, recall, Krippendorf, and for D sub 0, you have the total number, and then you have the number in disagreement. That's why it doesn't matter which is which. And then the number there's disagreement and number of low risk, in this case, number of low risk, high risk. In our case, it would be the number of no CTS, CTS. So that's where you get the 29 and 21. In our case, that is
zeros first, so that's 30 minus 1.
Should I work the whole thing out?
Alpha equals 30 minus 1 for 1 minus 30 minus 1. And this is something that is very easy to do. That's why Krippendorf is great. So it's 1 minus 30 minus 1, the number of disagreements, which is 5, over the number 17 times 13. And that ends up being 0.34. And it does usually have a very, it does always have a very close agreement with the kappa. And it's interpreted the same way. The only reason I'm having you look at and think about Krippendorf is because it's another technique that's available. And this guy, I got to remember to edit that out of there because the only part of this that you want to look at is the part up to there. So, cross, almost did it. So, cross this out. That shouldn't be there. Okay? And as I said, 0.34, you can, if you're comfortable with it, there's some controversy about it, but if you're comfortable with it, look at Carpenter's classification scheme for interpreting the agreement statistics, because he has a range in there. I can't remember exactly what it was, but I think it's, it goes from 0 to 0.2, 0.2, 0.4, 0.4, 0.6, something like that, and he has rating scales. That's a good rule of thumb, there's something to matter with it. Okay? And then finally, the last one was the same type of a problem. And actually, this is, even though I made up the data, this is something that economists do have to eventually learn to do to some extent, is know a job well enough to estimate by the exertion of someone doing it and classify the amount of exertion. Usually, tripartite is about as much as you can get to. Because any more resolution that just by observation is impossible without measuring it. But some, if you know a job well enough, you can develop maybe a tripartite scheme like that where you can classify the amount of exertion by observation. Okay. So, for for kappa, this is what kappa looks like. And we get a 0.437. What that would tell me, if I came out with kappa like that, and I had two ergonomists that were doing the same job, is that they both need to do some more training to get better agreement. That's the typical use of something like that, is whether or not they've both been trained consistently enough. And in this case, it would appear that they haven't. It's a kappa statistic. Since I can't open Krippendorf, let's forget about that for the time being, and we'll talk about it a little bit later. But since I can't open it, I'll go get a copy of it. Did you print out Krippendorf?
No.
Okay. I'll have to do that.
I read it.
That's okay. I just wanted a copy to project that. I'll try to print out the part that's that I need. So that was the homework for today. And this is a typical time that I take on homework at the beginning of each class, is about an hour.
Does the kappa statistic indicate that they both need to go to training, or that training could be the source of the poor agreement?
It could be a number of different things. First of all, in answer to your first question, do they both need to go to training? Don't know.
Okay.
At this point, this doesn't give us enough information. So we probably have to test them both again before sending them both to training. It looks like, you know, A is better than B. Maybe they both need to go, maybe only one, don't know. But it indicates a problem. Other questions? Okay, well, why don't you take a break until a quarter after, and then we will finish up topic two.